Hebrews chapter 6, where we are today. Hebrews 6, 1 through 8. Once saved, are you always saved? That's our question for the day. Listen to what the Hebrew writer says, chapter 6, starting with verse 1. Therefore, leaving the elementary teachings about the Christ, let us press on to maturity, not laying again a foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God, of instructions about washings and laying on of hands and the resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment. And this we will do if God permits. For in the case of those who have once been enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and have been made partakers of the Holy Spirit and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the age to come, and then have fallen away, it is impossible to renew them again to repentance, since they again crucified to themselves the Son of God and put him to open shame. For ground that drinks the rain, which often falls on it and brings forth vegetation, useful to those for whose sake it is also tilled, receives a blessing from God. But if it yields thorns and thistles, it is worthless and close to being cursed, and it ends up being burned. Have you ever wondered if you could lose your salvation? Do you know today that if you died, you'd go to heaven? Do you know you are saved, or are you just hoping so? Good questions to think about and to answer. The Greek word for apostasy means falling away. Now, interestingly, that's not the word that's used here. The word apostasy, that means falling away, is found twice in the New Testament, 2 Thessalonians 2:3 and 1 Timothy 4, verse 1. And the word means basically deliberately abandoning the faith. But here, if you look at verse 6, where we have the words fallen away, there's a different Greek word used. But in the translation, it's basically saying the same thing. Here, the words fallen away mean to give up the faith you once professed. So it's a choice that you're making to give it up. When we consider these two different definitions, I think it's pretty easy to understand that you can lose your salvation. Consider this illustration. Once I go to bed, I'm not always in the bed. I'm only in the bed until I get out of bed. Pretty easy to understand, isn't it? Once I get into my fishing boat, I'm not always in my fishing boat. I'm only in my fishing boat until I get out of my fishing boat. Once I log on to my internet, I'm not always on my internet. I'm only on until I log off. You see, it's the same way with our salvation. Once you decide to obey God's word in faith, believing in Him, repent, confess, are baptized, you're saved, but only as long as you stay saved. Only as long as you continue to be faithful in your Christian life. Our text makes it clear that once we are saved does not mean we are always saved. Consider with me this morning just two things. The way to assure salvation, and the way that it's dangerous. Verses 1 through 3 is telling us the way to assure our salvation. Verse 1 says we have to be willing to leave the elementary teachings and go on to something more basic than that. We have to press on, it says, to maturity. Now, it's important to understand that leaving is not the same thing as forgetting. Okay? You all left behind a long time ago your ABCs and 1 + 1 = 2, okay? But you haven't forgotten it. See, there's a difference. The elementary teachings, these are the ABCs. But once we know our ABCs, we go on to something more. We go on to putting those ABCs together and making words, and then reading with those words. It's not that we forgot the ABCs. We didn't forget them, we just left them because we're going on to something better. The idea of leaving is moving on from the beginnings that we've had in Christ to things that are even better, maturing in Christ. It's not that we forget, you know, the steps of salvation or those first things we learned, but we just go on to other things and we build upon those elementary things. The basic idea of leaving or moving on but not forgetting is that we move forward towards perfection or completeness. As long as we're making progress in the right direction, we will have the assurance of our salvation. You see, growing in Christ is normal. It's the natural thing to do. That's, I think, one of the reasons why the Bible refers to it as the new birth, or being born again. You know, when a baby is born, they don't stay that way. It's natural for them to start growing. You know? Urban Bella just had a new granddaughter. She's not going to stay that way. In fact, I bet she's already probably gained a pound or so. You see, as Christians, we're not supposed to just stay there when we become one. We're supposed to grow. We're born again. We begin then growing from that point. The Hebrew people were being discouraged because they weren't growing. And so the Hebrew writer is writing to encourage them to go beyond the elementary stuff, to go beyond the basics, getting into the meat of the word, going on to perfection and trying to learn even more. You know, I think one of the reasons there are people in the churches that don't go beyond becoming a Christian is because they know if they learn something, then they got to do something with it. So if I don't learn it, then I don't have to do it. See, that's pretty dangerous stuff, thinking that way. Because it may not even you may not even make it to heaven if you're thinking that way. There were people who were seeking a deeper meaning than what, you know, the people that were giving up their faith were seeking. These were the people I think Paul was wanting to encourage as he was writing here, if indeed he was the author. I think he was, but for those of you who don't think so, throw that in. When we fail to press on to maturity, what we do is we lay again the foundation for repentance. And that's not a good thing. Because we think we've got to work our way to heaven that way. We think we've got to do all these things, and that's not right. What we fail to do are the things that God's instructing us to do. Growing, maturing, going further, deepening our relationship. What this means is that we can't depend on our salvation coming from our good works. We repent of trying to get to heaven by doing good works. And we trust that the work God has already done is all we need for salvation. I can't do enough good works to get to heaven. Neither can you. Jesus has already done what's necessary for us to get to heaven. We just have to embrace it. We have to follow it. We have to practice it. verse 2 gives us more of these elementary teachings that we should leave behind and press on to maturity. Instructions about washings, that's probably a reference to baptism. You know, there are some people in churches even that their whole emphasis is getting people baptized, and that's it. That's not right. We need to go beyond that. Once we're baptized, we don't stay there. We grow and we increase in our faith and in our knowledge. Laying on of hands is another one that's mentioned here. That seems to be a blessing that was given to set someone apart in maybe a ministry or area of service. Resurrection of the dead is another one that's mentioned. The basic belief that the Jews and the Christians had was that they needed to leave that behind and go on to maturity. Eternal judgments, another one that's mentioned here. It's the last one, actually. Basic belief that was common knowledge that these believers had. They were sometimes doing things out of fear rather than out of wanting to really respect and follow the Lord. We should remember that there is a future judgment coming, of course, but we shouldn't let that dictate all that we do. You know, we don't go to church every Sunday because we know in the future there's a judgment day coming, and if the record's looked up and we miss church all the time, that's not going to be in our favor. So, but that's not the reason we go to church. We shouldn't let that motivate us, although it can be sometimes a good thing. We should remember to move forward. That's where our thinking, our effort, our concentration should be. In doing things that are good and right and positive. And that'll take care of the other things, the fear and all that. Verse 3 kind of sums it all up. Telling us that these verses, 1, 2, and 3, are saying that the Hebrews knew their ABCs, and I bet all of you here today know your ABCs too when it comes to spiritual things. But we need to go beyond that and move on and pursue perfection or maturing in Christ. The verse 3 ends, says, "And this we will do if God permits." Well, I have good news for you. God does permit that you pursue perfection, that you mature in Christ. So maybe a better question is, if God permits, it's not if God permits, it's if you permit. Will you do it? Will you pursue perfection? Will you pursue maturing in Christ? It's really up to you, because God permits it. He does. He allows it. He wants it. For you. Do you want it for yourself? That's the way to assure your salvation, by leaving those elementary things and going on to the more important things. But in verses 4, 5, and 6, he talks about a way that's dangerous. And he was speaking to the Hebrews, but it also can apply to you and me as well. He says if the Hebrews didn't leave these elementary teachings, they didn't pursue maturity and perfection, says they will lose their salvation. And that's a pretty dangerous thing. That's a drastic warning. And the case is made here to show the danger of not pursuing maturity, not pressing forward to those things that are better. He says, and listen to these things, "Those who were once enlightened, those who have tasted the heavenly gift," which is, I think, the Holy Spirit, "those who have been partakers or partners with the Holy Spirit," that's undoubtedly a description of Christians. "Those who have accepted Jesus as the Messiah," those who have been saved, That's the description about who he's talking to here. He goes on and says, they have not only tasted the Holy Spirit, but have tasted the good word of God. And the powers of the age to come. In other words, they did more than just follow the plan of salvation, get baptized. They had experienced the Holy Spirit in their life, which we get when we're baptized. They had experienced the Word of God in their daily lives, it seems. Verse 6 makes it clear. It says, these people that we just talked about, that he's describing, says, they have fallen away. So if you're once saved, you're not always saved. Because you can fall away. That's what's being said here. We have to understand that there's a difference between falling down and falling away. Okay? You and I, we're going to fall down. Okay? We're going to blow it. We're going to sin. We're going to make a mistake. But you know what? When we do, we're sorry. We ask God to forgive us. We get back up and we keep on going. But what he's talking about here are people who don't just fall down. They are people who fall away. They choose to give up God and go their own way. When that happens, they don't repent. They don't feel sorry. They crucify the Son of God again and put him to open shame. And that's their choice. And verse 6 says, it's impossible for them again to repent. Because they've deliberately chosen to fall away and give up their faith. And give up following Jesus. In 1 Timothy 4 verse 1, it forecasts that difficult times would come when there would be a lot of people who would fall away from following the Lord and from the faith. They would abandon it and begin to follow deceiving spirits. That's a very dangerous path to choose. Because choosing that path, following that lifestyle, it's an irreversible path that leads to hell. Matthew said about that, the road is wide that leads to destruction. The road that leads to heaven is narrow and few people find it. So what is the lesson here? Verses 7 and 8. These two verses don't seem to fit the other six. Until you understand what's being done is an illustration is being given. It's been given to help us understand the first six verses. The lesson here is for those who were considering leaving the faith. They'd once embraced. Verse 7 and 8 talks about ground. Ground that the rain is raining upon. It reminds me of the parable Jesus told in Matthew 13 of the four different kinds of soil. The parable of the sower, where the sower went out and he sowed the seed and fell on four different kinds of ground. There's good ground, there's bad ground. Good soil, bad soil. The good soil is useful. It produces a harvest. It produces fruit. Bad soil does not. It produces weeds, thorns, thistles. That's the verse 7 and 8 is talking about here. The faithful Christian who presses on to maturity is good soil. The rain comes, and the crop that grows is good. Because he's really trying, he's really doing his best to grow onto maturity, to do what the Lord wanted to do. And so the result of that is there's good crops that come. The bad soil, those who do not press on to maturity, it only produces thorns and thistles, and it's going to be cursed and eventually burned. It's a description of heaven and hell right there. And the choice that we have that opportunity to choose heaven or choose hell. We have that opportunity every day, actually. You see, we can choose to press on to maturity. We can choose to live for God, or we can choose to give Him up. A faithful Christian who presses on to maturity is going to make some mistakes, going to fall down. He's going to be sorry. He's going to pray and ask God for forgiveness and get back up. Keep on going. Now, even the best soil has weeds growing in it. But you see, the person who's the good soil takes his hoe out there and takes care of those weeds that are growing. He doesn't let them keep growing. That's like the person who's pressing on to maturity. Yeah, I made a mistake. I admit I made a mistake. I'm sorry I made a mistake. I ask God to forgive me, and I go out and I take care of that weed. Not going to hang around my life anymore. I'm going to do something about it. See, don't listen to the devil's tricks. He'll tell you once you're saved, you're fine. You can do anything else you want to. You can even sin if you want to. It's okay because you're saved. But you're only saved as long as you remain faithful. You can lose your salvation. That's what this passage is telling us. You can fall down, but you don't have to stay down. You can get back up. You dust yourself off. And you can keep pressing forward in your faith. Today you can have the assurance that you're saved. You can know beyond any shadow of a doubt that if you die, you go to heaven. If you don't know that, then maybe you need to make a decision today. Come forward, accept Jesus Christ, be immersed into Him, and begin pressing forward. That new birth. After that new birth, you start growing, going forward in faith. You need to make a decision. We invite you to come as we stand and